beta ansatz states, we should solve beta equations for beta roots, but this is a numerical procedure. I mean, there are no analytic formulas which give you all beta roots. So how can we say that we have an analytic solution of the system, right? And we will see that in the thermodynamic unit, the situation simplifies at least for certain observables and certain problems. And it turns out that in the thermodynamic limit, some small details about the actual beta roots is lost, so to say, and we can get analytic formulas for final results, which can be compared actually to experiments. So I will be concentrating on the thermodynamic limit, and by this I mean I will take a large volume limit together with a large n limit, n is number of particles, and I want to keep them fixed, the ratio, I want to keep the ratio fixed, which will be called particle density. And I want to look at certain physical properties, for example, ground state energy. Now, as we will see in these models, it just turns out that if we do these two limits together, then the situation simplifies a lot and we can get completely analytic results. So what type of problems do we want to consider? Well, I will consider again the XXX spin chain, but also the Liebig-Legendre model a little bit. And I want to look at the ground state energy, behavior of the ground state energy in this thermodynamic limit. We should specify little things, a little bit more the details, what I understand by thermodynamic limit. So in the Liebig-Legendre model, the ground state energy is actually zero because the ground state is the vacuum state. So you remember that in the Liebig-Legendre model, we can add particles and one particle has a single particle energy, which is given by P square in some normalization. It is always positive. If you add the particle, you always increase the energy. So the absolute ground state is the vacuum state, which has zero energy. It's completely trivial. But then for physical experiments, what is important is to look at a finite particle density, so a lot of particles in some volume with finite particle density, and then to find the ground state energy corresponding to the given particle density. So what we want to do is keep small n fixed, and then I want to look at ground state energy density, which is somehow the limb of, ground state energy over volume. I will put here L to infinity, or I can also write T, thermodynamic limit or something, with n fixed. This is what I mean. Somebody could also say that this is a pointless thing because in experiments you never go to infinite number of particles. I mean, you can get maybe a couple of hundreds or a couple of thousands of particles. I mean, still, this is a pretty much approximation. So when you do numerics, then you observe that, I mean, depending on the situation, maybe after 10, 20, or maybe already 100 particles, but that's typically really enough, you approach this value of the strict thermodynamic limit with very good numerical precision. So actually what we compute for the thermodynamic limit is pretty much relevant for experiments for thousands of atoms. I mean, some people have more experience with this, sometimes even 10 or 20 particles is completely fine and completely enough. It depends on the specific problem that we are looking at in any case. So this is what we want to do in Liebig-Legendre model. What do we want to do in Heisenberg spin chain? So Heisenberg spin chain is antiferromagnetic in the way it is written here. We have, let me draw again. Let me draw the spin Z eigenvalue somehow. We have the zero, which is half filling. And if we are in a some finite volume, then we have the completely ferromagnetic state pointing upwards and completely ferromagnetic state pointing downwards in Z direction with spins and eigenvalues L over 2 and minus L over 2. So these are ground states of the ferromagnetic Hamiltonian, and we use these, I mean, we use actually this state as a reference state, as a vacuum state, so that we considered excitations, Bethe Ansatz particles, which were excitations when we were moving somehow here downwards. Now, the ground state of the antiferromagnetic Heisenberg spin chain will be at half filling, so spins that equal zero. So this means that it will have a total number of particles. How should I write? Maybe I should write it here. N will be equal to L over 2. For simplicity, we take even volumes. Then it is really a singlet and it can have S that is equal zero. If volume is odd, you can still treat it. You will have a spin doublet. It's a little bit, it's not even more complicated computation. For simplicity, we just look at this case. There are some interesting issues about odd spin chains, but for the moment, let us consider really even cases. So we want to go there, it will be a singlet. It is a singlet, you remember I had the statement that beta Ansatz states are higher state states, and higher state state with spins at zero can be only a singlet. So it is a singlet state, and we want to find it. And also we want to find its energy density, which is given by this formula. However, maybe this is not the only thing that we want to find. I mean, sometimes we want to add the magnetic field to the Hamiltonian. I'm not writing it there, but because there is not enough space, but you just imagine that I can just take a different Hamiltonian with the integral 1 plus h times the total Sz. And then, depending on this h, magnetic field in z direction, the ground state can change. Why is this? Because obviously, I mean, different states have different magnetization, and then it gives a contribution to the energy. I mean, if magnetic field is very large, or in either positive or negative direction, then you can imagine that the ground state will be the ferromagnetic state, again, completely polarized state. Because, I mean, if this is very small, this is very large, and this dominates completely, and then we just get the ground states according to the spin z eigenvalues. It's pretty clear. However, if it is an intermediate value, then it's possible that we are somewhere in between. So what we want to do also in this case, we want to look at the ground state for any kind of fixed particle density, n over L, where this particle density can go from, let's say, 0 to 1 half. I mean, 0 is ferromagnetic state, 1 half is antiferromagnetic ground state, but we can be in between somehow. Because if we are at some fixed particle density, we compute its we compute the ground state energy of H, then the ground state energy of H prime is simple, we just add these two things. I mean, Sz commutes with this, so I just have to add the corresponding Sz eigenvalue. I mean, just for clarity, so the corresponding Sz eigenvalue is L over 2 minus N. I mean, if I substitute this, then of course I can write it somehow. How should I write it? I write it like volume times 1 half minus small n. Okay? So this will give an energy density which is 1 half minus n. So to say, competition of these two things will matter. And in order to find the ground state of H prime, I need to find the ground state of H at any kind of n. So this is what we want to do. I mean, this is one of the plans that I want to do, and we will do it actually today, not everything. Today I will give you a final formula for the ground state energy of the singlet, of the antiferromagnetic state, and I will explain what to do with other cases. But that's not the only thing we want to do. In the second lecture today, or depending on time, let's see, we also want to look at excitations. And let me discuss what type of excitations we want to look at, because it's important to keep it's important to have a good picture in our head. So one thing is that we want to find the ground state, right? We discussed this. But then we want to look at excited states somehow En, which are maybe close, maybe a little bit far away from the ground state. And then we need to somehow separate eigenstates according to excitation energies. What do we want to look at? So one of the most typical situations is when we look at states which are separated from the ground state with an energy which is of order 1. I mean, this means order L to the power of 0. So finite excitation energy as we take the thermodynamic limit. So this will be extensive, this is also extensive plus a small contribution to the ground state energy density. A little bit of excitation above the ground state. This is a very typical situation, and we can easily develop methods to compute properties of such states and excitation energies. Now, what is also very important and very interesting, but today I will not go there, is to consider gapless systems. So sometimes we have gapless models, and actually the X66 feature is a gapless model. X6Z is sometimes gapless, sometimes gapped, depending on the anisotropy parameter. X6X is gapless. Now in gapless models, you can have situations where you have the low-lying excited states. They are such that the energy difference with respect to the ground state scales as 1 over L. And then what is important is to find how many of these states are and what are prefactors of this 1 over L scaling. These are low-lying excited states which exist in these models. Again, it exists for X66, And it exists for x, x, z, for the delta smaller than one. And for delta bigger than one, it is depth. In that case, we can only have these types of states. Well, is that there are actually two ground states exponentially degenerate, but afterwards we have such excited states. So if you consider such states, then you can also make a connection to conformal field theory. Because that's also important how you relate these theories to conformal limits. Anyways, this is what I will not treat in this lecture due to time limits. I will focus on these types of excited states. But I will also focus on a third type of excited states. So this was one type, another type, and then one more type, which I call highly excited states. So it can happen that the energy difference between our state and the ground state is of scales of L, ordo L. So this means that energy density of this state is different than energy density of the ground state. When can we have such states? I mean, obviously, in every experiment. Because in an experiment, I mean, to actually go to the ground state, you need to cool down your system. And sometimes you can say that you are very close to the ground state if you go to really, really low temperatures. But typically, there is also a temperature in the system. And if you have a finite temperature situation, then you have an energy density which is different from the energy density of the ground state. And also in these experiments, and also in many theoretical computations, people are doing these quantum quenches, transport, generalized hydrodynamics, generalized Gibson sample, etc., etc. And all of these states have finite energy density above the ground state. Also in experiment, what you construct, you start from an initial state, you prepare your system somehow, and you cannot prepare it in a ground state. And if it is very well isolated from the environment, then it will have a finite energy density above the ground state. So we need to understand these states also. This is what I call highly excited states. And we need to have some kind of formalism for these states. And hopefully we will actually treat it a little bit, not everything. I mean, if we have finite temperature situation, then the standard method is the so-called thermodynamic Bethe Ansatz or Young thermodynamics. I believe it will be treated by Andrea Trombettoni. I will not go there. I mean, again, just time limits. I just mentioned that this belongs to that area. Okay, so this was introduction to what I want to do and to have a good picture in our head. And now let us actually start the computations, okay? And I will not specify so much what type of model I will be talking about, because the situation in XXX spin chain and Lebesgue model is pretty similar. We want to have a fixed particle density. We want to look at energy density of the ground state. And apart from this, we will see that it is very much similar. So I will do this. I erase this and I will start almost immediately. I just have to add one more comment to have something in our head. But let me just erase this. So in order to study ground states, let us go back simply just as a reminder to three bosons and three fermions. As a simple reminder. So if we have three bosons and we have a fixed particle number in some volume, if we draw a picture with respect to energy, then I mean the ground state is Bose-Einstein condensate state. So everybody occupies the lowest energy level, B in C state. However, if you have three fermions, then we have Pauli principle. So Pauli principle means that fermions cannot occupy the same mode. So in energy, they will occupy some neighboring modes. And of course, they are degenerate. So sometimes, if I draw a bit with respect to energy, then we have degeneracies very often. So resolution, of course, that you will see degeneracies, but it's not, they are not the same states typically. But if I draw the states in a momentum space, I need to change this term. In momentum space, then we have probably principle, and then typically they are something like this. So in a finite volume, finite number of particles, the ground state is a completely packed state where particles occupy the neighboring modes. And this extends to the Fermi boundary, which I draw like this. And then if we go to thermodynamic limit, this is very well known. What happens is that Fermi boundary is more or less fixed, but we just pack more and more particles and they will become dense in this, within the Fermi zone, the distribution of particles will be dense. And if I draw with respect to P, then the distribution of particles here will be actually uniform, even. Because quantization condition is A3IPL is 1, so possibilities for P is 2 pi over L multiplied by some integer quantum number. So clearly, distribution is even, because we just pick integer quantum numbers, neighboring integer quantum numbers, and we multiply it to the same factor. We can compute energy density simply using the integrals. So energy density will be simply something like this. It's actually equality. Something like integral from one fermion to other fermion, A of P, something like this. Maybe 2 pi, etc. should be fixed, but something like this. We will fix the precise formula in the next whiteboard slide, so to say. What else do I want to add? I want to add here that I can also draw a similar picture in the space of quantum numbers. But then what changes that in the space of quantum numbers, I mean, this is quantum number space, they do not become dense because quantum numbers are integers. So in the space of quantum numbers, what we will have is that they start to occupy more and more. So the Fermi boundary of the space of quantum numbers will increase with the volume, I mean, because of this rescaling. So only in momentum space do we have the Fermi boundaries. Here it gets wider and wider. And I'm drawing these pictures because basically this is what we will have in our Bethe-Ansatz solvable models. I said earlier, I mean last lecture, that our Bethe-Ansatz solvable models somehow satisfy Pauli principle, at least in almost all cases. So they behave as very similar to free fermions. They are not free. We have interaction, but in some sense they behave similar to this one. So we will not have this. We will have this situation with some kind of modification. So let us understand what type of modification this is and how we get the ground state energy. I will now erase. One more important thing is to discuss that the energy as a function of rapidity is always such that, at least for these models that I always, for these models that I'm treating, that the minimum is at A of lambda is at lambda equals zero. I mean, this is important. You remember that for Heisenberg spin chain, this function was equal minus 1/2 1 over lambda squared plus 1/4. It's very important that this has the minimum at lambda equals zero, which is a function like this. So this means that if we add a fixed number of particles, then from an energetic point of view, it is good. It is favorable to add particles which have rapidities close to zero. So similar to the free fermion case, what I was drawing here. So somehow, if I draw now a rapidity plane, I can make some assumptions. These assumptions should be checked. So one assumption is that maybe in the XXX spin chain, it is good to look at real rapidities only, one strings. This assumption should be checked. But I was arguing that the energy corresponding to one string, I mean two one string, is always lower than a single two string, for example. It has to do with the antiferromagnetic nature. But also numerically, you can check that eventually the ground state will consist of real rapidities only. So we go to this previous case, and we only put rapidities on the real axis. We don't have to care about strings when we construct the ground state. And then what we can also imagine that as we include particles in our system, it is somehow favorable to add particles around zero. But we have the Pauli principle, so we cannot put all particles to zero or very close. We will have some particle distribution on the rapidity distribution on the real line. Now we should figure out what is the rapidity distribution as we add more and more particles and as we go to the thermodynamic limit. It's a very natural assumption based on the free fermionic case that it will be something very similar to the free fermions, that you will have some kind of Fermi boundary again. And within the Fermi boundary, we will have an even, not even, we will have a smooth distribution of rapidities as we go to thermodynamic limit. More and more rapidities we pack there. But now the distribution of rapidities is not necessarily smooth. I'm using the wrong word always. Not necessarily even, not necessarily uniform. So what we will see, there will be a so-called root distribution function or root density function, which describes us the density of beta rapidities in a resolution in lambda. We will see this. So how do we find this distribution of beta roots in the thermodynamic limit?
Excuse me.
Yes.
Question. Can you say once more why it's in a, we can neglect the strings basically? We can only consider the string centers.
So I have two arguments. I mean, one argument was that if you take two real rapidities, lambda one and lambda two, and then you just compute e lambda one plus e lambda two, sum of two body energies, then this is always smaller. And it's a negative value, so in magnitude it's bigger than if you would take a two string. So you take a two string, you take lambda c minus I over two, lambda c plus I over two. You consider the energy of a two string with respect to string center. This is also two particles, this is also two particles, but the energy of this is typically less. It comes from the property of this function. We computed it that. How was it?
Okay. It's less, but one has to sum all over the string. So, what matters if they are negligible in the thermodynamic limit or not?
Yes. I'm not saying this is a proof. I'm saying that this is an argument which gives you an intuitive understanding why it would happen. But I'm also saying.
Then can we check
that this? Yes, but the check is from actual computation. So the check is that there are different ways of how you check. You can go to Bethe Ansatz equations and you say you fix volume is equal to I don't know 8, which is already some non-trivial value, and you compute all solutions to Bethe Ansatz equations, or you make exact diagonalization and you compare states. So you take, for example, exact diagonalization and you take some solutions of Bethe equations. You match the states, it's possible, and then you see which is the ground state. And then you can say that this is a mathematical experimental check.
So it's a computational experiment that confirms.
Yes, that's what okay. I was trying to say.
Okay, thank you.
I have to say, I mean, there are these. So there are these computations which show you, which tell us that if we start from this ground state with this assumption, and then we make some kind of change, so we add the two string or get the three string, then we can see that the energy is increased if we just add one two string or if we just add three two strings. So I will come to this point, but I will not completely finish it. So for some cases you can check that. If you make a small modification to this state, then energy always increases. So this is also a good sign, but it's still not a completely rigorous proof, right? So it just tells you that this state is somehow a local minimum, okay? This can be proven, I think. Is it a good answer?
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
But to see that this is the only local minimum or the absolute minimum, this is difficult.
Okay, so in addition to the string hypothesis, there is also this hypothesis here.
Yes, I would say.
Okay.
But again, I stress that it's a very natural thing because we have a state where we do a little bit of any kind of little bit of modification and energy is increased. And this is proven, so I mean, it would be a little bit unnatural to have two local minima. And in that case, it would be something like a force vacuum. So you do a small excitation above this, then energy increases. But if you do a big modification, then energy could be still lower. This is very unnatural. But I cannot exclude it with any kind of simple argument. Okay?
Okay, clear. Thank you.
Yes. So then we want to find the beta roots, distribution of beta roots in the ground state. And we go to Bethe equations, and now I need to make a little bit of change to Bethe equations. And actually, I think it was by Giuseppe Del Vecchio that we go to mention this bosonic formulation of Bethe equations, because it's more useful in some sense. So we will go now to logarithmic form of Bethe equations, and we make a little bit of sign change. So originally the Bethe equations were like this, that e to the I p j l multiplied by this product k not equal j s of lambda j minus lambda k. So this was equal one, and now I make a modification here. So I want to define that maybe I will do this. So I want to define that s of lambda is minus e to the I delta of lambda. So it's a shift in delta with pi, if you wish. But this is better, because then we can have a situation where delta of zero is zero, and then we can define the branch cut of the logarithm just following this, continuously following this point. Otherwise, the branch cut would be difficult. I mean, you add the pi or you minus pi, or I don't know. It should be fixed, but this is a good fix, and this defines you what is delta unambiguously. I cannot pronounce this word, but yes. And then I said we take logarithmic form. So when we take logarithmic form, then we need to be a little bit careful, because some minus signs accumulate. So I will add the deltas here, but then we will have some minus 1 to the power of n minus 1. And we will take it into account on the level of quantum numbers. So what I will write, I write pjl plus some k not equals j. Actually, I can put equal in one sec. So delta lambda j minus lambda k is equal to 2 pi times some number I of j. And now let us discuss this sign. So if n is even, then here we have a minus sign. Then I mean that ij should be half integer. I mean, integer plus 1/2. And if n is odd, then ij should be actually integer. Right? I think this is also that.
I will run out of these things.
And this is clear. I mean, if we look at even n, so then it should be positioned somehow symmetrically around zero. So if we go to momentum quantum number space, then we should have a situation like this, even momentum quantum numbers. And again, the assumption is that the ground state will be such that on the level of momentum quantum numbers, as we go to thermodynamic limit, we have a closely packed situation. So we have Pauli principle. It is not possible to occupy the same states. And then it turns out that this also means that we cannot occupy the same momentum quantum numbers for two different rapidities. Again, this has to be checked. I mean, this is not completely obvious, but believe me that this is the situation that you can call it again a numerical observation. I don't know how to argue. Maybe it can be argued from here somehow that if Pauli principle is satisfied, so no coinciding rapidities, then it will mean that for the ground state, momentum quantum numbers are tightly packed, very similar to free fermions. Maybe you can argue a little bit as a deformation away from free fermions. So you can have you can have the XXZ spin chain where this delta can be tuned continuously from free fermions to XXX case, and then this argument can be actually checked as a continuous limit. You remember that in XXZ spin chain, we have this delta parameter and delta equals zero is free fermions. And if we move away, we can move back to delta equals one. I cannot again prove it rigorously. We just have this situation. And then we want to look at the solution of Bethe equations as we go increase the number of particles, we increase the volume, which is a parameter here, and the momentum quantum numbers are tightly packed. This is what we want to do. Right, now we should solve it somehow. And the natural idea is to somehow make an assumption that in rapidity space, there will be a distribution of rapidities, find this distribution of rapidities somehow, and the method is to turn summations into integrals. I mean, this is very natural, what everybody would do. I mean, instead of this sum here, maybe you just write an integral. And actually, because of this property, I can put here summation over all k, right? Because delta at zero is zero in this condition. So I will turn this sum into an integral. But we also do a little bit of trick. The little bit of trick is the following. I take difference of two equations. So let me put some convention for the ordering of rapidities such that this will be, I mean, this momentum quantum number will correspond to particle one, this to particle two, et cetera, et cetera. And then we will have a situation, believe me, we will have a situation also that lambda j will be always smaller than lambda j plus one, and p of j will be smaller than p of j plus one, using this convention of ordering of particles. And then what we do is we take difference of equation corresponding to index j and of equation corresponding to j plus one. So I of j plus one will be equal to I of j plus one separately because they are tightly packed. So if I take difference of the equation corresponding to next index, I subtract this one, then I get just 2 pi. I will write it to the left hand side actually. Or well, how should I write it? I don't have space, so I will write this 2 pi here, yes. So after taking subtraction, how should I write that? That it will not be confusing. So that is something which corresponds to this with index j plus one. And then I take subtraction of equation j plus one minus equation j, and it starts with 2 pi here. Now then I get p j plus one minus p j multiplied by volume. And then what do I get? I get a summation over k, right? Both have a summation over k, but on the first equation I have lambda j plus one minus lambda k. And in the second equation, I delete this one. So minus lambda k, and then I take difference lambda j minus lambda k. Right? And this is equal to, this was 2 pi here, sorry. Now this is more advantageous, this formulation, because now I don't have to care about the momentum quantum numbers anymore. It's just a simple trick, but this trick is actually very useful. So we have a fixed 2 pi here. Now we have these differences here, and eventually this sum will be turned into an integral, but we want to do something with these differences. And I think it's very obvious what we want to do. I mean, particles will be condensed somehow here. So in order to compute these differences, we will actually approximate these functions with the derivatives, and we will express everything using lambda j plus minus lambda j, the difference between two neighboring rapidities, so to say. Well, how do we do this? It's very simple. So we take, now we make an approximation, but it will be a good approximation in the thermodynamic limit. In some cases that it can be proven. So what I will be doing now, this can be proven. There is a paper by Karol Kozlowski where he actually proves some of these things. Maybe everything, I do not know what is the details of the paper. So it's a very standard method, but some people actually spend time to prove that this is good. So I take a derivative of p with respect to lambda. So p of lambda derivative, evaluated, let's say, at lambda j, multiplied by lambda j plus minus lambda j. And then here I will get summation over k still. I will take the phi function, which is the kernel, derivative of delta with respect to first variable, and I evaluate it at, let's say, lambda j minus lambda k, and again, I multiply by lambda j. I multiply with the same thing, lambda j plus one minus lambda j. So we should do now something with this difference. And now is the good time to introduce to introduce the root density. So, well, will you remember this? So I can erase it. Now I introduce the root density. So the idea is to take, so to say, replicative space and take any kind of delta lambda, and then the root density rho of lambda is defined such that the number of particles within this segment should be approximated by rho of lambda. No, well, I shouldn't write it like this. So definition is the following, that delta n, number of replicatives within this segment, should be equal to rho of lambda multiplied by volume and multiplied by delta lambda. So the assumption is that this should hold if delta lambda is big enough so that we can have some average situation within the segment. Okay. And this is clearly the scaling. We have more and more particles, they become more and more dense, just like in the free fermion case. Good. But then how does this relate to this object? Well, it relates that like that, that on average, what we can write on average is that a little bit stupid way of writing, but I can argue that it will be okay. We have within this segment, so to say, we have one particle, because we take this segment and we make one jump from one particle to the next. So what I can argue is that now delta n is equal to one, and then delta lambda is equal to this lambda j plus one minus lambda j. And then clearly we find that this value, so lambda j1 minus lambda j, is equal to 1 over L multiplied by 1 over rho of lambda. And you can say that this is stupid because here I was talking about average the distribution and I'm taking delta n equals 1. I mean, the way out of it is to take difference of not neighboring positions but a little bit more far away or something like this. So it really works. So I take this one, then what do I get? I substitute this formula here. I mean, the same factor is here and here. So what I do is I can simply just either leave L there or, we forgot here, this L is also here. Nobody noticed. I mean, this is here. So when I take this formula, then here this L will be canceled. Here, the one over L remains. But I multiply with rho of lambda to the left hand side. So I get 2 pi multiplied by rho of lambda is equal to p prime of lambda evaluated at lambda j. This is also lambda j. Here everything is fine because L is cancelled. Then here I have 1 over L, summation over k. I have kernel lambda j minus lambda k. And then what else? 1 over L is okay, and this is already taken out. Now this is very nice. What remains is to replace this sum by an integral. And now we have this 1 over L. So clearly when we replace the summation according to this, it should be turned into volume times integral over lambda multiplied by rho of lambda. By definition of what is the root density. Now here we have 1 over L, here we have an L, so this cancels. What we get is 2 pi times rho of lambda j is equal to p prime of lambda j plus an integral over d lambda, rho of lambda, and I will just keep with me one sec, phi of lambda j minus lambda. And now we should, maybe the lambdas are a little bit, so I will write now lambda tilde. This is an integration variable. So instead of summation over lambda k or replicatives, this is an integration variable. And the integration goes from where to what? I mean, the integration should go from Fermi zone to Fermi zone. I mean, to Fermi boundaries, which we don't know yet. And I mean, now here we get this index, a free index lambda j. But this should hold for every lambda j. So I promote this equation to an integral equation, actually. So I forget the j index, and I write it down separately here. I erase it because this we don't need anymore. So I write down separately that equation is the following. Maybe I should write 1 over 2 pi to here. It's a standard way of writing. So rho of lambda, for some lambdas, I will explain in a moment, minus, I take this to the left, it's a standard way of writing, conventional way of writing. Minus Fermi-zone to Fermi-zone, d of lambda tilde, rho of lambda tilde, phi of, now this is lambda minus lambda tilde. Maybe I should write it in a different order. Okay, so just to have the standard conventional way, it doesn't matter, but maybe it's better to, with better visibility this way. And this is equal to 1 over 2 pi multiplied by p prime of lambda. And the equation should be valid for every lambda within the Fermi zone. Okay, so lambda can be any value with, from minus Fermi boundary to Fermi boundary. And then this is almost okay, but then the problem is, what is the Fermi boundary? Well, the total particle density is just equal to the integral from one Fermi zone to another Fermi boundary, d lambda rho of lambda. Because by the definition of particle numbers. So we have two equations, and we should solve somehow these two equations simultaneously. And then this will give us two informations. One is what is rho of lambda. Other information is what is this Fermi boundary. What is the input from the model? The input from the model is, well, on one hand side, p prime, this function. On the other side, scattering kernel, which is this function. This comes from interaction. And it's an input what we put for from our side, what is particle density. Because when we specify this, this will clearly change the Fermi boundary. I mean, if we have low particle density, then Fermi boundary can shrink. For larger particle densities, Fermi boundary can increase. And what is very important, that this part is actually a linear integral equation. It is very easily solved. Sometimes it can be solved analytically, sometimes numerically. So when you go to Lieb-Linegar model, then typically you would solve these two coupled equations numerically. In Heisenberg's spin chain, sometimes you can solve it analytically. Sometimes you can solve it numerically, depending on what you are actually doing. So I think now it's a good time to have a break, and we will continue with the antiferromagnetic concept of the XXX model. Any questions?
So these are the questions for the string centers.
Yes, but I'm talking only about one strings. So okay. String center and rapidity is the same.
Okay.
I mean, to this question, in some models, actually the ground state consists of two strings. For example, the spin one version of XXZ and XXX spin chain, it's an integrable version, which has a specific Hamiltonian, very specific. Then the ground state consists of two strings. And then you can write down the same equation for the string centers of two strings. But that's a different model. Now I'm talking about a model where the ground state consists of one string only. So here rapidity is.
Balázs, one more question, please. In the Bethe equation, we had the restriction that index j is not equal to index l. Okay. And in the final integral equation, where is that restriction?
So I think it disappeared in the moment when I was taking this when I was using this. It is valid, but I can. Where should I put it here? Maybe. Okay. So remember that we had S of 0 is equal minus 1, and then we defined that this should be equal minus e to the I delta. And this means that delta of 0 can be chosen as 0. And then we can just put this, I mean, we can just forget the restriction. Because the restriction was over k not equals j. But if I have k equals j, then I have to have lambda, no, delta of lambda j minus lambda j. So delta 0 is 0.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, I think
another question. Maybe it's a bit naive, but I wanted to ask you, because it's not really clear to me why this bosonic formalization is better than the fermionic one in this case, which is convenient here.
I mean, for me, the only convenience is that in the space of quantum numbers, I could draw this figure, which is very similar to the Fermi case or the free fermion case, that quantum numbers will be symmetrically placed and you can have the same picture in your head. Otherwise, it would work also for bosonic formulation. I mean, but then for the bosonic formulation, maybe you would have something like more complicated situation that maybe unnatural a little bit. That if you actually compute the quantum numbers, maybe they will be placed like this, or I don't know.
Okay.
I wanted to have the same symmetry with respect to space reflection on the level of quantum numbers. And I can guarantee that this holds only if I take a very specific choice for delta. I mean, I can also explain it a little bit as, like, you remember that S of lambda multiplied by S of minus lambda was equal 1. And clearly, this should correspond to delta lambda plus delta minus lambda is equal 0. But of course, this is not the only choice, because I take logarithm, then maybe there will be a 2 pi here. So, with this specific choice, I can guarantee that this equation holds.
Okay, thank you.
Do there are other questions?
I'm kind of curious, like, so what kind of experiments do people use to kind of like solve with Bethe Ansatz? Like, nothing. I'm just wondering if you know some interesting experiments. Kind of.
Related. Oh, yes. I mean, a couple of them. I mean, you know, the researchers, we need to apply for money to fund the research projects. And for the research proposals, we always, it is good. We don't need to, but it's good to write experiments. So I have a collection of citations that I need to add in these cases, what are experiments. So why we are doing the theory. And for example, I don't know so many theories, so many experiments with XXX spin chain, but I know with the Liebig-Wieniger model, because this is, I mean, very actively studied now. And what people do, well, I'm not an expert. I mean, maybe I know that there are some people in the audience who are much more expert than me, but they really take a collection of atoms, I think maybe rubidium atoms, or rather, I'm not completely sure, I don't know all the experiments, and they put them into a trap, 1D trap, where there is also so strong confining in two directions, so atoms can move only in one direction. And there's also, in order to have a finite system, they also put a confining potential in the longitudinal direction, but that's that breaks integrability, but that's not a very severe breaking of integrability, well, in some sense. And then they look at the motion of atoms in this experiment. There is a very famous experiment called the Quantum's Newton Cradle, which people are very happy to mention first, and also I'm happy to mention it first. So what they did, I don't know, well, I have little time. I will not describe all the details, but I mean, this should be really a topic. I mean, Andrea, will you talk about some such experiments?
Yeah, I will talk. Go on, and then I will comment later.
Okay, I will be very quick. So what people did, they put a very, very little bit confining potential. So this is x coordinate. And this is value of x. It breaks integrability a little bit, but not very much, so that atoms would be likely to go to the origin of this potential. And then in the experiment, what happened? They put a cloud of atoms to the left and a cloud of atoms to the right, and then they let them evolve and move, and they approached each other. There was a scattering, and then there was an oscillation of atomic clouds, and it was a big thing that the system did not actually break. So there, and this lack of equilibration over, I don't know, like a couple of hundreds or maybe thousand, I don't remember how many cycles, this was a clear sign of integrability of the model, because there is no momentum transfer. So when clouds of atoms meet at the bottom, there is no momentum transfer. So energy is not transferred into low energy modes. Kinetic energy has to stay with the rapidities, with the particles. And that's why they observe this kind of motion for a very long time. It is similar to classical experiments with pendulums, this classical Newton cradle. I will put a link in a chat box. This is one very famous experiment. But that's not the only one. I mean, in some models, also some properties of spin chains are measured. And so I also like it very much. There is an experiment regarding to the E8 related Ising model, so massive perturbation of Ising model. I mean, it's also a remarkable experiment. I will put the link. You know, E8 is a Lie algebra or Lie group, exceptional Lie group. It's not not one of these series. And there is an integrable quantum field theory which is related to this Lie group, where mass ratios of particles are given by some eigenvalues of quantum matrix sizing. And it turns out that in experiment they measured mass ratios, and then they just measured the experimental. No, in the experiment they measured mass ratios predicted by this Lie algebra, so to say. So it's quite amazing that a very exotic Lie algebra, some properties of this Lie algebra was actually measured in an experiment with spin chains. It's very remarkable. I will also put this in a chat box. But that's just two examples. I mean, it's a separate course should be on experiments.
That's very satisfying. Yeah, thank you.
I just add that since in the next week we'll talk about more in detail about Liebliniger, and now experiments differently from, I don't know, 10 years or 20 years ago can be done online, so that the experimentalist let the experiment to be done in their experiment by let's say, setting it online. I will try to show, with the help of experimentalist colleague, an experiment on a Liebliniger, if I manage to, together with them. So just to say that, yes, there are experiments.
I am here, so we can start, depending on Andrea and others.
For me, it's okay. I think we can restart.
Okay, so let me add into the chat box these two links. Somebody said, Jerome, what?
I think Jerome put the Young, yes. Young thermodynamics paper.
Yes, that's nice.
Jerome.
So, and I will add this quantum Newton's cradle. I will also send to Filippo separately.
Okay.
That's one. And then this, what I really like, this E8 related result.
Okay.
Because in science, you can check here. But at the end, I will send these links separately to Filippo to have it. And then, I mean, if somebody really wants, there are some reviews of experiments with beta ansatz, but I am not happy about the status of these reviews because they are a little bit old. So I don't know who should write, but somebody should write a more current review. I mean, there is some review on archive called, also paper from beta ansatz to experiments, and then there's also thermic acid, something with bachelor, and I don't know. So I can look it up, but reviews are not completely up to date, I would say. It's a task for someone, certainly not me, because I'm not working with experiments, but somebody should do it. Anyway, let us start. where did we stand? So we have an integral equation where particle density is also an input. In the Liebliniger model, you need to solve it by hand. There is no analytic method, as far as I know, to give an exact solution. I mean, explicit solution using n, where you would find a big lambda and rho. But there is a simplification in the Heisenberg spin chain in one case. So in the Heisenberg spin chain, as I said that in the introduction, that maybe we would want to look at not only antiferromagnetic ground state, but at any particle number. But now let us just go to the simplest case. And simplest case is really antiferromagnetic ground state, so ground state of this Hamiltonian. And then in this case, we are at half killing, n is equal to 1/2. And it just turns out that in this simple case, the equation can be solved analytically. Why is this? I will say again, the statement is that lambda becomes infinity. I mean, I don't really know. Again, you can call it an ansatz which you actually confirm afterwards. So I don't know how it is figured out in the first case. Maybe it's a very natural ansatz. I don't know. It just turns out that if you put lambda to infinity, so you forget integration boundaries and you integrate from minus infinity to infinity, also here, you solve this equation, then you will find that n is equal to 1/2, and ansatz is confirmed, okay? And if we have an integration from minus infinity to infinity, we have here a convolution, then you know that standard tricks can be applied, that convolution is equal to multiplication if we go to Fourier space. So idea would be to take this equation and go to Fourier space, and then solve it in Fourier space. So we need to have some kind of convention for Fourier transform of some functions defined on rapidities. Maybe I can write, this is integral of, I don't know, d lambda e to the I k lambda, where kk will be Fourier component, f of lambda, and then inverse Fourier transform will give you the 1 over 2 pi vector. And then we need to do the Fourier transform of this, and this here, we get the multiplication in Fourier space. And the Fourier transform of the quantities, this one and this one, is important. It is an input. And you remember that we already computed this function and we computed this function. So let me again look to my notes, because I know the functions up to normalization, and sometimes I just mess up the normalization. So the functions are phi of lambda is 2 over lambda squared plus 1. This is even correct. I computed it. Well, hopefully. I always forget if it should be a bit of minus sign or like this, but it's very important. I computed it at home. I think this is correct. Hopefully. I mean, we can confirm it if we have a problem. So p prime of lambda is 1 over lambda squared plus 1 over 4. This is also easy to compute. We had this before. Now we should do a Fourier transform on that. So we need
isn't there also a 1 over 2 pi in the integral equation in front of the integral?
Yes, of course. Thank you very much. I forgot. Yes, thank you very much.
Otherwise, you have to put that in the definition of phi. Some people do this.
Yes, thank you very much. I mean, it was there. I was saying it, but then somehow I forgot. Thank you very much for noticing. Yes, because the original the 2 pi was only here, multiplying this, but then I divided it and then should be here and here also. Yes, very good noticing. Thank you. I mean, this 2 pi will matter when we do this convolution in Fourier space. So hopefully these formulas are correct. Hopefully I didn't make any mistake at home. And then the equation what we get is, well, here we get a multiplication in Fourier space. So we need to take Fourier transform of these two. How do we do it? I mean, you have this integral, you have this, and you make a standard trick of residue computation. So you continue upwards or downwards, depending on k, what it is. And then you find that the Fourier transform of phi is actually, what is it? 2 pi times e to the minus k absolute value. And the Fourier transform of this p derivative function is 2 pi times e to the minus k magnitude over 2. And then if you substitute them here and you take care of this convolution together with this 1 over 2 pi, then you can get an equation, a linear equation for Fourier components of rho, and using this put here, and the answer that you get is simply rho of k, or the Fourier transform of rho of lambda is equal 1 over 2 cosine hyperbolic of k over 2. Maybe this is a homework exercise, but it's a boring homework, so I apologize. There is nothing very interesting about this. In order, maybe you can confirm my computations. You just need to be careful about the 2 pi factors, etc. So it's a boring homework. I apologize, but maybe you can confirm. I mean, at least one time, it is good to confirm these things. And then we should transform this back to real space. And when we transform back to real space, then we find that rho of lambda is actually the following. Hopefully, again, no mistake, 1 over 4, 1 over cosine hyperbolic of pi lambda over 2. And then this is defined for the whole D line. So lambda going from minus infinity to infinity. And you can check, but this is actually very, very trivial, that if I take this equation that I integrate from minus infinity to infinity, indeed I should get 1/2, but this 1/2 is simply, in this normalization, I think this is simply the Fourier coefficient at k equals 0, and Fourier coefficient at k equals 0 is 1/2. You see it already here. So I don't need to integrate again backwards. So it's 1/2 as expected, because we are at half filling. So this confirms my educated guess that lambda was chosen to be infinity. So we have the root density function as a function of rapidities. I mean, you can also see that it is biggest when lambda is at zero, and otherwise it is quickly decreasing. So this means that we will have lots of particles around zero rapidity, but much less when we go to bigger rapidities. This confirms my original arguments about the energy. And what do we need eventually, or finally, I can put it here. We need the ground state energy, or ground state energy density. Again, small e, we have very many e's, but anyways. So this will be integral of b lambda, rho of lambda, and a of lambda, where a is the single particle energy. I mean, this is already the thermodynamic limit, but it's very clear that how you take it. Now, this can be evaluated again in Fourier space. I think this is most easiest. So you go back to Fourier space in lambda and also in A, and then you need to do a Fourier integral. And I don't think I should go to details, but I hope I didn't make any mistakes. And then this is minus 1/2 integral deca in Fourier space from minus infinity to infinity, and then we actually get 1 over 1 plus e to the power of k absolute value. Now, this can be replaced going from 0 to infinity, and after replacing the integration variable, and you do it, eventually you get simple final answer, minus log 2. And this is it.
What the fuck?
Yes. So let me rephrase what we achieved. So we computed an exact analytical answer for a very non-trivial property, ground state energy of a strongly interacting ground state. I mean, it is okay, it is integrable, so it is special. Of course, it's special because we can solve it, but still it is strongly interacting. The S matrix is a non-trivial thing. It's not a small coupling or perturbative expansion or something. This is an exact ground state of interacting theory, and there is no reason why we would expect a log 2, right? I mean, where does logarithm come from? It comes from this integral, but when otherwise there is no reason to expect a logarithm or something. So it's one of those remarkable nice end results that we can get with integrability. And let me point out one more thing. I don't have time to go there, I really, but just as some kind of interesting look towards more complicated results, I will delete this one now because I think you have seen it. What is even possible in these models to take ground state mean value of operators like, for example, spin Z at side j and spins are at side j plus 2 or j plus 3 or j plus 4. So you go to next to nearest neighbor, next to, etc. Go to distances bigger and bigger, and you take a correlation function, for example, between z and z. I mean, we have SU2 invariance anyway, so in the ground state it doesn't matter. You can look at this particular correlation function and evaluate it in precisely the ground state. And it just turns out that for small distances, you can compute exact values for this, which will be similar to this, but actually it will include, I think, Riemann zeta function at some special points. I don't remember exactly, I can look it up, but I don't remember. Anyway, you will find exact numerical values for such correlation functions, which is very remarkable. It's a complicated theory. It took people a long time to find this theory, so it's not something simple which you can cook up very easily. It's a very complicated thing, but eventually final numerical answers are given, and mathematical analytic answers are given, which can be, well, checked with numerics. So you can also do exact diagonalization, check the correlation function, evaluate it in a ground state, and then you find some value, and you see that already in relatively small chains it approaches it. So it's a remarkable result. All right, I don't want to say anything more about this, because this is our final answer. And we don't have so much time, actually we have 25 minutes, so we should go to excited states a little bit. Maybe I will finish this part tomorrow, maybe today, let's see how it goes, okay? We should talk about nature of excited states. So we have this diagram in lambda space, where again we have this Fermi zone. I mean, okay, in our previous case the Fermi boundary was infinity, but let us forget it for the moment. Let us go back to situations where we have a Fermi zone. This is more general. I mean, Lindinger model, but you don't see it. And then we have some density of Bethe roots, which with lots of Bethe roots here. And then I want to look at small excitations, but not the lowest excitations. I mean, lowest excitations can be treated also with similar methods. There are small differences, and I don't want to look at those more technical details. So I want to look at the most simple thing. And the most simple thing is when we make excitations which are either particles, so-called particle excitations with finite momentum, or so-called hole excitations. And from a intuitive point of view, this is very simple what happens. What happens is we take ground state and we add one more particle here, for example, at some rapidity. This is a particle excitation, and we can do this in a free model. This is very easy. In a free model, we have these momenta here, we just add one more momentum here and we are done. Now, we have an integrable model, and in the integrable model, we have interaction between the particles. So if we add a new particle, then these particles will be a little bit shifted, because the Balázs equations for these particles are also sensitive to the addition of a new particle. The shift is not very big, but there will be a shift, and we need to treat this shift. In terms of particle physics language, we can call this a backflow. So we had an excitation, it is a finite excitation, so just one particle, but this one particle will cause a little bit of backflow on the other particles, and the backflow should be also proportional to 1 over L. We will see this. So this is a particle excitation, and there is also a hole excitation. I mean, I think you can guess what is a hole excitation. So hole excitation is you take the ground state, but then you just delete one. I deleted by hand. Okay, so there is nobody there. I deleted one particle. This is a hole. Again, in a free model, you just take out one particle and then you are done. You have an excitation. But in a data ansatz, if you take out one rapidity, then the other ones will be shifted again with the backflow function. So we need to treat this. And then physically, what is maybe even more relevant is the combination of the two. So the particle changes particle number by one, hole changes particle number by minus one. And clearly we can have the so-called particle hole excitation. What is it? I mean, particle hole excitation is when you take one particle, you make a hole, but then you also add it. So you just shift this one particle. I will draw it like this. So you move one rapidity from, so to say, within the Fermi zone to some outer position. This is called particle hole excitation. It has two parameters. The two parameters is position of the hole and position of the particle where you put it. So we can actually regard it as two excitations in some sense. You will see it actually behaves as two excitations. And believe me that when we treat the effect of backflow here on these particles, then really these two things can be done separately. So a particle hole excitation can really be considered as a sequence of making the first a hole and then a particle, or in the other order. So the backflow effect will be actually linear. So in approximation, in a 1 over L approximation, the backflow caused by making a hole and the particle, they will be just additive. I mean, exactly, of course, it's not additive. So if you treat exact equations, it's not additive. But if you are already in large volume, large lot of particles, and we consider shifts of these rapidities when we make something here, then it will be additive. So this is simple. And then today, the only thing that I want to treat today is the particle excitation. And I mean, hopefully we will finish it. It's not that complicated. Whole excitation will be very similar to it with some negative sign somehow. So let us then treat the particle excitation. So I will delete this, and what we have in mind is simply we have our ground state, which consists of Bethe somehow, and we add one more particle here. One more comment, very important comment, that in the spin chain for X66 model, it is more complicated than what I will be talking here, because then we need to add, for example, two string. It's a technical detail, but it's all important. So if we are at half filling, then there is not much possibility to add one more particle. I mean, also in rapidity space, so to say, the particles are completely filled. This goes from minus infinity to infinity. So it's not possible to just add one more particle with three rapidity. We need to add the two string or whole. But now let us consider, for example, Leibniz model, or let us consider X66 model where we are not at half filling, so smaller than half filling, then there is really a lambda and minus lambda Fermi boundaries, and we can just have one extra particle. So this is a simpler situation. I'm just restricting to this because of time limits again. When we go to actual models, then there are some small details which need to be changed. I will now show the general picture of what is happening. So the general picture is the following. So we want to make an excitation above the ground state. So let us imagine that we have the ground state rapidities, which go from lambda to lambda big N. And we are in finite volume, but very large volume, lot of particles in finite density. This was our ground state configuration. Now what we have, we add one more particle, and then we expect that the new state will have one more particles and some rapidities, where this corresponds to a little bit of change of the original rapidities, and then we have an extra rapidity, I will call it U. Okay, and I expect that this U will be outside the Fermi zone, and these are within the Fermi zone and still tightly packed. And we make an assumption that for each of these rapidities or the original rapidities, lambda j tilde minus lambda j should be of order 1 over L. This is an assumption, but when you look at Bethe Ansatz equations, you understand that this is really a very natural idea, because the Bethe Ansatz equations feel a lot of information about the other particles, and then one extra particle, the weight of one extra particle is of order 1 over L compared to all the rest. So that's why I expect that this change will be of order 1 over L. And actually, it is good to think about it not only as a thing which is over 1 over L, but to really give it some smooth value. But what I mean by smooth value is that I introduce a function here, which I call shift function, which will depend on lambda j and also on u. And we can make this assumption that it will be smooth. So for lambda j is close to each other, the shifts will be very similar. There can be only subleading terms to this, over 1 over L square or something like this. Again, it's a very natural assumption. When you look at Bethe Ansatz equations, this is the first thing which comes to your mind. The shift should be a continuous function. And then the goal, what we want to have, is compute this shift function. Why do we want to compute this shift function? Because eventually I want to look at excitation energies, and the excitation energies have to be expressed using the shift function. Let me explain this. This is actually also simpler. So I want to compute energy of the modified state. Let us call it E prime. Now, R tilde, because we have tilde, sorry. E tilde. Energy of modified state. So altogether, it is a summation over k going from 1 to n of E of lambda tilde k, plus separately, I have E of u, because I added this part. Now, this is typically an energy contribution which is of order 1, right? But what about this one? If I take a difference with respect to the ground state, then I get E tilde minus E0, then I get a summation over k 1 to n e of lambda k tilde minus e of lambda k plus separately e of u. And here we can look that we have a summation of n terms, so this will be extensive, so to say, but this difference will be 1 over L because of this shift function. So I can assume that eventually this will be turned into an integral with a finite value. So this will be turned into integral from minus Fermison to Fermison boundary. What do I get? E prime as a function of lambda, I have d lambda. Then I have the shift function coming from this shift. So I have, I want to let this cancel because of the integral. So I have f of lambda slash u. And I also have the true density function because I get the root density when I turn the summation into integral. And this is also an order one value. And then separately, I have e of u. So I cannot forget this one. I cannot forget this one. The backflow of the other particles will also give an order one contribution to the excitation energy. And it's very important to compute it. And let me just say that this is a remarkable thing that we can compute such objects, because something like this is also happening in quantum field theory very generally. I mean, there's this idea of quantum field theory that maybe you can get it from filling up the direct C, right? Or from a continuum limit of certain models where you also have some C of particles. And then it's very natural that if you have an excitation, then it causes a backflow on the C of particles. And generally, this backflow is very difficult to compute. I mean, maybe you would do it from numerics lattice quantum field theory or something like this, or maybe you cannot do it at all. But in our case, you can compute the backflow exactly, or up to these integral equations. So we can treat it with analytic methods, and with numerically arbitrary precision, we can compute it. That is a remarkable property again of these integrable models. So we see that we see here that rho of lambda for the ground state is known. We assume it is known. We need to compute the shift function. This is also known. This is known. We need to compute the shift function. How do we compute the shift function?
When we turn the summation into an integral, maybe there is also L over 2 pi. Or not?
Because so there are two things. I mean, first, when I replace some by integral, then I replace it now with this one. I think here there is no 2 pi, and L is there. Sorry.
Okay. Yeah, 2 pi is not there because I rapid. Okay.
But L is here cancelled. So the shift is 1 over L.
Okay. They cancel. Thank you.
Yeah. So we need to find the F function, big F, the shift function. How do we find the shift function? We find it by looking at Bethe Ansatz equations, and I will be looking at Bethe Ansatz equations of these particles within the C. I mean, the Bethe Ansatz equation for this particle can also be written down, but it will not contain too much information. I mean, the reason is that we will go to infinite volume, and in infinite volume, the possibilities of placing these particles will be very dense. So it doesn't matter precisely where this particle is. And if you put it somewhere, its information is not so important. All information is that it should be roughly at rapidity u, okay? But for this shift function, we really need to go to the Bethe Ansatz equations for the particles which are here, because this will give us the movement of the backflow, so to say. So we go there, let us go there. Space is a little bit limited, so I need to rearrange a little bit the blackboard.
Sorry, Balázs, may I ask a question? So yeah. The calculation that you are doing, it is valid if this excitation energy is order one, so if the model is gapped or?
Yeah, it's also valid for gapless cases if you move here, yes. I mean, the problem is that if you have a gapless situation, then maybe the movement of these things is 1 over L square or something like this. Because then you move your particle very close here. And and then the problem is that you cannot argue that U will be finite.
Okay, thank you.
But even in gapless models, there are some states which have this structure.
Yes, but okay, thank you.
Yeah. So, well, how should I put it? What is the quickest way? I mean, let me write down two Bethe Ansatz equations. So I pick just one particle with index j, and I write down Bethe Ansatz equations originally without this extra guy, and then also in the new situation. Let me write it down, and then we will see. So originally, p of lambda j l plus sum over delta j minus delta k. I can now write again over all k is equal to 2 pi a momentum quantum number. It's j. It will be a very important step here. There will be a very important step in a moment. Now, after I add the new particle, this becomes lambda tilde multiplied by n now. Also, sum over k delta lambda j tilde minus lambda k. And then separately, I have delta of lambda j minus u, but I add this. I will be here and multiply by 2 pi I of j. Now, question is, why do I write the same object here, same momentum quantum number here? So what is the good answer to this? I mean, I don't even know what is the best answer. If I assume that the momentum quantum numbers are not changed, then I get a description of a backflow and of this this expression, but I get an order one shift. If I would assume that momentum quantum numbers also change or some of them change, it will be a much more complicated situation. Maybe it will give also the same change, maybe not. It depends a lot. So I think this is also an assumption that I do not want to change momentum quantum numbers in these intermediate particles. And the only thing what I change is the addition of a new relativity. And sometimes if you go to explicit computations also for low-lying states, then you can again check this. I'm not saying that this is a completely evident, that this is only possibility. I mean, it's also possible that you take excited states where you change momentum quantum numbers here a little bit, then some of the relativities will be a little bit arranged, and then you can get the still same excitation energy. So there is a lot of, maybe I'm feeling stupid now. That's only if I can, I think I was a little bit stupid here. Let me think, I'm messing up two situations. So these are completely packed. So if they are completely packed, what could happen? I mean, in the worst case, we could put two of them together. I don't know what is the best argument. Maybe somebody in the audience could give a better argument. My argument is again something like it's an ansatz and this ansatz works. So I just make the assumption that these momentum quantums are not changed. Forget about what I said with rearrangement. This was about finite temperature cases. It's not possible to rearrange momenta because these are tightly packed. So in the integer quantum number space, they are tightly packed. We cannot shift them a little bit. But what we could do is to put two of them together and look, maybe there is a good solution to the Bethe Ansatz equations, but typically this is not happening. Okay. So I made this assumption, and then again, what I do is the same trick as before. I take difference of the two equations, and from the difference, I want to express this change in the lambdas, the shift function. So stay with me, we have some minutes and we want to compute this. So I want to keep this formula, the final formula here, and I need space, so I will erase a little bit. Hopefully it will be enough space, if I erase this one. And this one, so we keep this in mind somehow for future, and then let us compute the difference. all of my pens are somehow going dead. I did not think that I would talk so much. Is blue visible? No, green. Is it visible?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I will get new pens for tomorrow. So I take difference. Then I from here, what do I get? I have again p prime at lambda j, multiply from this by shift function lambda j parameter u, but L is cancelled. Then I get sum over k. I get the kernel, because I take difference here and derivative again, at lambda j minus lambda k. I get again the shift function. Wrong. I made a mistake. Again, nobody corrected me, but this should be also tilde, and this should be also tilde. Sorry, it's just mistakes. I mean, this is beta ansatz for the new state, but of course, the new state consists of these rapidities. It's very important. So if I have here, if I take difference of these two, then there will be two terms in the difference, because lambda j is also changed and lambda k is also changed. I mean, I wanted to write this, but somehow I forgot the tilde for the second one. I messed up two equations, sorry. So here we will get f of lambda j u minus f of lambda k u, because k is also changed and it is of rapidity difference form. What else do we have? Separately, we have this plus delta at lambda j tilde minus u. But now in this term, eventually I will replace all tilde with j, because the shift are already taken into account. Now this is equal to zero. And what is more important is that here is a one over L, which we should not forget. And we will now turn this summation into an integral, where one over L will be cancelled. So what do we get? We get p prime at lambda j multiplied by shift function plus I have integral of d lambda from minus fermion to fermion. I have rho lambda, and then maybe I should write here, what should I write? So this is lambda j. Okay, lambda is now integration variable, not to be confused with this lambda j. This lambda comes from the lambda k. I have phi of lambda j minus this lambda. And then I have f of lambda, lambda j at u minus f of lambda u. And then I write separately this is minus lambda j minus u. What else can we do? We see that in this integral, we integrate over lambda, but somehow this part can be pulled to the front. I need to erase this. We will write it out again if we are that far. So this can be pulled to the front, and then I will have a term which is f of lambda j and u. Now this is multiplied by a big expression. The big expression has p prime of lambda j. It has it with a plus, right? Integral minus lambda, the fermion, d lambda, rho of lambda, phi lambda j minus lambda. And then I have a minus, and then this is under the integral now. So I have integral from minus lambda to lambda, d lambda, rho lambda, phi lambda j minus lambda, and then f of lambda u. This is equal to minus rho lambda j minus u. And what is this? And if you go back to one slide earlier, we will actually realize that this is nothing less than, let us not mess up the 2 pi factors. I think this is 2 pi times rho of lambda j. Just go, rewind on YouTube, or if you made notes, then you go back on some pages on your in your notes, and then you find that this is rho of lambda j. And then what we see, we are almost there. Stay with me. What we see is that we get a combination of shift function and rho here. Also here, combination of shift function and rho. So it is good to introduce a new function. What type of letter should I put? I don't know. So I introduce that f lambda j u times rho of lambda j. I call it, little f. of lambda j and u. And for this little f, I get a something simpler equation. I continue now here, a little bit shorter and very similar to the previous one. So I have, very importantly, a 2 pi here. I have little f of lambda j u. From here, I have a minus integral d lambda phi of lambda j minus lambda. And then I have here the little f at the lambda and u. And this is equal to minus delta of lambda j minus u. And then what we do is to change now notations a little bit. So I, for this integral, I will use a different variable, and I will actually call the lambda j as lambda. Sorry, but to make conventions the same. And also I will put this 2 pi here and here. So my equation is, after changing notation, that f of lambda and u minus integral d, well, not lambda, sorry, I just said, let's say omega over 2 pi, phi of lambda minus omega, f of omega, is equal to minus 1 over 2 pi and delta and lambda minus u. Now, this is what I wanted to have. Now, this equation, when you go up to what we had seen previously, equation for rho, it has the same form. So for rho, we have the same equation. So this is an integral equation which comes up very often. It plays a part in the so-called dressing procedure. I mean, if I have maybe 5 minutes, I think I have 5 minutes, then I will explain this dressing in a moment. So what we...
Balázs, sorry, I don't see well. The second question is f minus integral. Yes. Okay, f. Okay, okay.
Yeah. So if we pick a repetitive u, which is our excitation, then we know this input. This is the source term for the integral equation. And we have a linear integral equation, which we solve. Okay, integral goes from minus fermion to fermion, as always. So we have linear interpretation for this f. And here I also forget it has a parameter u, but this you can guess. So parameter u, which we solve for f. And if we have the little f, then we also have the big f. And if we have also the big f, then we know the excitation energy. So stay with me. This is the last thing that we compute, and then I give an explanation, and then we stop. So the excitation energy, this air tilde with respect to the ground state, was on the one hand side, it had the E of u, and then it had an integral over d lambda, going from minus lambda to lambda. It had rho lambda, the big F lambda of u, and energy derivative of lambda. This was it. And now we take this, but remember that the small f was this combination what appears here. So I divide it as E of u plus integral from minus big lambda to lambda, and then d lambda little f of lambda, the parameter u, multiplied by E prime of lambda. And this way, what we have, we computed the excitation energy of a particle excitation, and we computed the backflow of the other particles using analytic methods. And this is again remarkable. We have the backflow of the C, and its effect is exactly taken into account by this integral equation and this integral eventually. When you go to details, then of course, you cannot always solve it analytically, but sometimes you can. And then this is called the dressed energy. So this is called, I can introduce a new name, this is called the dressed energy function as a function of u. Because you see that the only parameter of this energy is, this function is the u. Because u enters as a parameter here, then you get the solution for the little f, and then you substitute the little f here. And also u plays a role here. So this only depends on u, but of course, in some sense, it depends on the ground state, I mean the C. It depends on the C from which you started, because it uses as an input the original rho. I mean, it's not here, but for example, it uses this minus lambda to lambda, and it uses the information that you have a ground state which is completely packed. For excited, for other types of finite temperature states, you could play the similar game, but then one more information enters. Before we stop, because I think we are just close to time, this is the Dresden energy for particle excitations. You can show that you get the Dresden energy for pole excitations, which is just the same thing, but opposite sign. So with the minus. You play the same game and you convince yourself that you have the same thing with the minus. And then the particle hole is just addition. So you have you take one hole from here somewhere and you put a particle here. And then you take two things, two backflows, you compute them and you sum them up. One will have positive sign, one will have negative sign. And the difference is your particle hole excitation. And last comment before I stop, just on time, is a homework, which is an interesting homework. Not so much interesting, a little bit of technical detail is required to figure it out. Think of this function as a function of U, and let us compute the derivative of the Dresden energy with respect to U. I cannot write, I mean, I'm sorry, I'm simply just not used to writing. So derivative of Dresden energy as a function of U, where you keep the ground state fixed otherwise. And then just show that this function actually satisfies a similar equation like this. So what it satisfies, let us call this function, I don't know, for simplicity, I will put R Dresden derivative. So let just show that this function satisfies this equation in a similar form. So it satisfies N E dress prime of lambda is equal to minus integral d omega phi of lambda minus omega E dress derivative of omega. And this is equal to plus 1 over 2 pi and phi, the scattering kernel of delta minus omega. So somehow this the derivative of the Dresden energy is even more simpler, because for the derivative of the Dresden energy, you don't need to solve the first f function and then this integral and then add something here, but then you get immediately this. But it's very simple, but you need to make some steps. And with this, I finish for today. Tomorrow, I want to talk a little bit about different topics. This was ground state and excitations around the ground state. Do I want to add any more comments? I mean, highly excited states is a different matter. For highly excited states, you will have lots of holes here and also lots of particles outside. So then you need to treat densities of particles and holes separately. It can be introduced with similar methods, and then you need to treat two types of densities, and then you need to treat ratio, which is a so-called filling fraction. And here I only treated real solutions, so when the particle is a real rapidity. But you can really extend this methodology to have two strings as a particle at excitation. Or you can also extend the whole methodology for highly excited states of x66, where you will have lots of strings, and for each of strings you will have particles, you will have holes, and for each string you need to take care of the density of string centers for particles, holes, and it's a long story, but it can be done. Long story, it can be done, and sometimes it leads to really analytic exact results. But okay, there's not time to everything. Tomorrow I will go to nested Bethe ansatz a little bit. I will treat the Young-Baxter equation, which is the algebraic fundamental for all of this. So I reserve tomorrow for that topic. Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Balázs. Do there are questions? Okay, I think we can stop here, and your next lecture is tomorrow at 2 p.m., correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe I can just ask a question, if there are no other questions. So here you derive the backflow equations directly in the continuum limit. But could you, I mean, in principle, you could do that in finite size, right? And what would you get then?
Well, I'm not completely sure what you are asking. I mean, there is, you want to get integral equations for infinite size, infinite particle numbers. I mean, there are methods for this.
No, I'm asking how, can you look at how the beta roots move when you, infinite size, when you add one rapidity or remove one rapidity? Okay, it's less naive as it sounds. I wanted to make a connection with the Coda matrix, but
I don't want to go there now. It's okay. Well, it's possible, of course, but
okay. I thought it could be explained not in a relatively easy way. But, okay, thank you.
So, if there are no other questions, okay, I think we collected the links in the chat and we send to Filippo.
I mean, actually, now thinking about it, but I'm a little bit tired, maybe for a discussion session in the afternoon. I mean, what Jerome says, actually it can be said in a short way. So I didn't plan it for today, but his questions, of course, it's a good question. So maybe we save this for afternoon discussion, okay? Jerome is right. This can be introduced in very quick way, so.
Okay. Yeah, thanks.